Welcome to our 13th virtual Sabbath School panel. I would like to introduce our participants today. On my right is Brother Michael Bowman. On my left, Brother Stanley Mackey and Sister Esmeralda Diaz. And my name is Frank Sanders. Our lesson today is the Bible and prophecy. First, let us open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for waking us up on this set-apart day. Now, Father, I pray for your guiding presence as we study your word. I pray for open hearts and minds to receive your word. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Now, our lesson says, Bible prophecy is crucial to our identity and mission. Prophecy provides an internal and external mechanism to confirm the accuracy of God's word. Jesus said, "And now I have told you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may believe." This presents a crucial question. How do we interpret Bible prophecy correctly so that we know when the prophecy has indeed come to pass? During the Reformation, the Reformers followed the historicist method. This method is the same one Daniel and John use as the key for their own interpretation. The historicist method sees prophecy as a progressive and continuous fulfillment of history, starting in the past and ending with God's eternal kingdom. This week, we will study the pillars of historicist prophetic interpretation. We are to see in history the fulfillment of prophecy, to study the workings of providence in the great reformatory movements, and to understand the progress of events in marshaling of the nations for the final conflict of the great controversy. Now let us turn to Sunday, where it talks about historicism and prophecy. If I could get somebody to read the caption under historicism.
The foundational method that Seventh-day Adventists apply for studying the Bible prophecies is called historicism.
Yes.
It's the idea that many of the major prophecies of the Bible follow an unbroken linear flow of history from past to present and to future. It's similar how you might study history in school. We do it this way because that is how the Bible itself interprets these prophecies for us.
Okay, go ahead.
So it's interesting how they bring this out, because historicism, this is the way I've always looked at the Bible, and this is a concept that really I was oblivious to early on in my Christian experience, because I didn't realize that there was any other thinking out there, really. And it wasn't until I was having a conversation with one of my friends about this, because he was debating a lot of people, via chats and stuff like this, and he told me that we're historicists. I'm just like, well, big deal. What's the big deal about that? Well, but it's important to realize that there's actually other thoughts of reasoning out there, which are just very, it's interesting how they put it together. But you also, because we have, once again, you have, futurism, right? And is everybody clear what futurism is?
It's about the events have yet to come. They're in the future.
Yeah, the events of prophecy are yet to take place. And then you have the other one, which is preterism, which, everybody familiar with that term?
That means it's already taken place.
It's already taken place. And the interesting thing is that there's a large body of the Christian community does not see his historicist flow as we look at the Bible. And it's also interesting, as the lesson already brought out, that the early reformers took a historical view of scripture, a historical view of prophecy. Mm-hmm. The Reformation, this is where Martin Luther was living, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he was seeing things from that perspective. But during the Counter-Reformation, is when a lot of these other ideas kind of came into play. And as Stanley and I were kind of chatting beforehand, I mean, this whole lesson, from when I was going through it, it's just like you really can't separate Sunday from Monday from Tuesday from Wednesday from Thursday. Because it's all kind of built on each other.
It is.
But the Counter-Reformation is where these other ideas came out. And part of that reasoning is to displace tagging something as being the center part of Daniel, which to displace blame, or not blame, but displace, right. To shift the thought process away from being correctly identified and therefore revealed in history. And so it's the deflection mechanism, basically.
Yes.
And it's been absorbed by the Christian church greatly, which is very concerning, very concerning.
Have any idea why that may be?
What?
What you just said.
Oh, about the two different mm-hmm. flows of thought? Well, I mean, to some extent, because as we will get into it, the whole idea is about this, the Antichrist and this little horn power, right? Mm-hmm. And so if you say that he's already come, then there's no need to look any further for anything else, right?
That's correct.
And so, but then the futuristic viewpoint says he's coming yet. He's coming yet.
Right.
Just don't worry. He hasn't come. He's coming yet. And so, and it's just very interesting too how they break down from that. Just really breaking down, especially like the 70 weeks prophecy. You know how it talks about the 62, the 69 weeks, then the extra week, mm-hmm. right? Well, that extra week in a lot of mainstream Christian thinking is yet to come.
That's right.
And that's where this whole idea about the secret rapture comes in and all this kind of stuff. So, but we take historical view as the Adventists have done, which the Bible's clear on that.
Yes, it is.
And even Martin Luther was very clear on that. And he was still living amongst these time prophecies, which hadn't been fulfilled yet. But he was able to see things looking back pretty clearly. Mm-hmm. And so I actually found a quote from he actually had written back in 1530. I'm not sure if you wanted me to.
You can go ahead.
Sorry, I don't mean to dominate, but it was just very impressive when I found. And this has obviously been translated from the German that I'm pretty sure he originally read had written it in. And this was written in 1530. You can find it on the internet. This is from stepbible.org. This is on Luther on Daniel chapter 7. And he says, from this we see the splendid great man Daniel was before both God and the world. First before God, for he above all the prophets had this special prophecy to give. That is, his work was not only to prophesy of Christ like the others, but also to count the times and years determined for them and fix them with certainty. Moreover, he arranges the kingdoms with their doings down to the fixed time of Christ, in the right succession, and it does it so finely that one cannot make a mistake about the coming of Christ unless one does it willfully. And from that point on till the last day, he depicts the condition and state of the Roman Empire and the affairs of the world in such a way that no one can make a mistake about the last day or have it come upon him unawares unless he does it willfully. And so it's just like, whoa, this is like 1530.
Yes.
We haven't done with the 1230 or 1260 day prophecy yet.
Yes.
One of the things as a student coming up, I remember the story of Daniel and the idol, the head of gold.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, post-Daniel, and when you get into the New Testament, we had not entered into the broken toes at that time. So was not there a futuristic belief in that we would be coming into the toes of the beast that had not yet happened, along with looking back at Babylon, who was during the time of Daniel being the head of gold.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we had both perspectives. We looked from a historicist view, and then we had a futuristic view post-Daniel prior to Europe and, mm-hmm. and the dividing of those countries there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's true.
And as you read through Daniel, I mean, he didn't even understand this. He's like, whoa, what's going on here?
You know, it's confusing to him. Yes.
Yeah, exactly. And then it came to the point where Gabriel says, you know, Daniel, close up the book, seal it.
Yes.
It will be open in one day, but seal it.
You know, what I find very interesting about the Bible is that no matter where you are, it always gives you the present as well as the past. Mm-hmm. And it always gives you a glimpse of the future, right? So no matter where you are, there's always some things that have already taken place, things that are going on now, and there's some things yet to come.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Does anyone else have anything that they would like to share? Let's go to Daniel chapter 2. Esmeralda, if I could get you to read Daniel chapter 2, verses 27 to 37, and if I can get you, Stanley, to pick up and read from 38 all the way to 45.
Okay, Daniel chapter 2, 27 to 37. Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, "The secret which the king hath demanded cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers show unto the king. But there is a God in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. Thy dream and the vision of thy head upon thy bed are these. As for thee, O king, thy thoughts came into thy mind upon thy bed, what should come to pass hereafter. And he that revealeth secrets maketh known to thee what shall come to pass. But as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I have more than any living, but for their sakes that shall make known the interpretation to the king, and that thou mightest know the thoughts of thy heart. Thou, O king, sawest and behold a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. This image's head was of the fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king. Thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom, power and strength and glory.
And wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of the heaven hath he given unto thine hand, and hath made thee ruler of them all. Thou art this head of gold. And after thee shall arise another kingdom, inferior to thee, and another, third kingdom, of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron, for as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all these shall it break in pieces and bruise. And whereas thou sawest the feet and toes, part of the potter's clay and part of iron, the kingdom shall be divided, but there shall be in it of the strength of the iron. For as much as thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay, as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. And whereas thou saw iron mixed with miry clay,
They shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. For as much as thou sawest that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it break in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God hath made known to the king what shall come to pass hereafter, and the dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof sure.
Now, what aspects of the dream indicate a continuous, uninterrupted succession of powers throughout history? Anyone care to share?
Well, each time there was a power that was defeated or that fell, and as we know, Babylon fell. Right after Babylon, there was other powers that succinctly became in power. And so, you know, this shows the immediate or consecutive power transfer.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Brother Mike?
I mean, just as Stanley said, you know, and we have the advantage of looking back over history. And this is kind of one point in which, you know, there's a lot, the critics of Daniel mm-hmm. are so strong on is how can this be so exacting? Because, you know, nobody can do this. This book had to have been written, you know, post AD or in the AD time period instead of, you know, when we know it to be like, you know, I think it's like 300 or 400 at least BC, right? And so when or actually before that. So Daniel, I mean, so a lot of people, a lot of critics just throw this whole book out, because if you throw the book out, guess what you can throw out along with it? Mm-hmm. You can throw the rest of the Bible out, because right.
Yes.
It's just a bunch of fairy tales.
And
as Stanley said, you know, it does show an unbroken history. And when you find, and then when they find the Book of Daniel in the Dead Sea Scroll bunch, you know, like, oh, okay, let's we'll ignore it, because once again, you have to admit that there's a God now.
Right.
You have to admit there's a God, and there's a lot of good stuff on this, but
yeah. How remarkable that a man can prophesy or predict a time period during a time when there were false prophets, and during a time when there were these men, these soothsayers, these wizards and people who tried but couldn't, and told the king, well, we need to know what the dream is before we can interpret the dream. But the king couldn't tell him. And he also told them, if you didn't, then you were going to be killed.
Yeah.
And they didn't, and they were killed.
They were on the chopping block anyway.
They were on the chopping block.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
And Daniel saved them.
There we go. That's the story.
Daniel saved
them. That's correct. And so, but Daniel told the dream and the interpretation.
Yeah.
And how
yes,
remarkable
he did.
Was that?
And just the humility of him, too. He's just like, you know, King, this is not from me. I have no reasoning in this, but from what God has told me. And it just he always points in the right direction. He doesn't say me,
that's
which
right.
He could have easily done.
That's right.
He's always pointing above, and that's just a remarkable thing about Daniel.
You know what I thought was very interesting about that dream was that image had all of history right there in that one image.
Yeah.
Starting with Babylon from the top all the way down. In that one large image, we saw all of history.
Yeah, yeah.
That was amazing.
And that's why it's so prophecy is so important to our belief in the Bible, because, you know, if because it does, it tells us history from before it even happened. And with that, what it does for me is it's like if Daniel revelation are true on this, then guess what? From cover to cover, everything is reliable.
Right.
It's not.
Amen.
And
yes.
So, It's a huge, for me, I'm not sure about for you guys, but for me, it's a huge anchor point.
Absolutely.
And it's just amazing how that works out.
You know, and it's also supported, you know, in the secular world, in the history books, right? So what we're seeing in the Bible, they're supporting evidence in our worldly books.
And even down to the description of the time periods. I mean, you have the period of gold, mm-hmm. you have the period of silver, you have the period of bronze, you have the period of iron. Mm-hmm. And then guess what? We have the period of reinforced concrete.
Yeah.
Even down to the building materials.
Right.
You know,
so.
Yeah. There is no way this could have just happened by happenstance. No.
And none of these kingdoms were restored to power.
No.
I think the pastor brought out last week that Saddam Hussein was in the process of mm-hmm. doing some restorations, but
that didn't
happen because of the Iraq War.
Yes, mm-hmm. got stopped.
Well, that was also predicted and prophesied through Scripture that these things would not, those powers would not come to be again.
Right.
And so,
even to present day, I mean, you know, Europe is fractioning. I mean,
right. Mm-hmm.
They've already lost the UK. You know, who knows what other toe is going to fall off now?
Yes. But yes, but this is true. Let's go to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. And verse 29. And it reads as follows. And now I have told you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may believe. Now, what is it that Jesus is saying? Because that's who's speaking here in John. Jesus is speaking. What is it that Jesus is saying that help us to understand how prophecy can function?
Just kind of like we've already ever talked about. It's just like, you know, Jesus is saying, hey, look, this is what I told Daniel. This is what I told everybody else. And it's coming to, when it comes to pass,
mm-hmm.
you can hang your hat on that.
Right. I told you beforehand. So when it happens, this is nothing new.
Nothing
it's
new.
Not like you haven't heard it before.
Shouldn't be a surprise.
I've shared it with you, mm-hmm. right?
Amen.
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 So it's amazing how it works out.
Yes, it is. It is. Let's go to Monday. Let's talk about the year-to-day principle. One of the interpretive keys of historicism is the year-day principle. Many scholars throughout the centuries applied this principle to the time prophecies of Daniel and Revelation. They derived the principle from several key texts and from the immediate context of the prophecies themselves. Let's look at some of those texts. Let's go to Numbers chapter 14 and verse 34. Numbers chapter 14 and verse 34.
I'll start up in verse 33 if you want.
Go ahead.
It says, as for your children shall wander in the wilderness 40 years and bear your warm whoredoms, until your carcasses be wasted in the wilderness. After the number of days in which ye searched the land, even 40 days, even each day for a year, ye shall bear your iniquities, even 40 years, and ye shall know my breach of promise.
Now, how do we get the year-to-day principle from that text?
Well, just as the scripture says, it's just like, you know, the spies went and searched the land for 40 days, and for each of those days, because you didn't believe what I said, and you didn't rely on and trust in me that I would do all these things for you, now you're going to have to, for every day that they were there, you're going to have to be in this wilderness.
So he's calling their memory back to something, the 40 days in the wilderness.
Yeah.
And then he's telling us that how we can apply prophecy to that is just that those days, change them to years. Mm-hmm. So what you experienced, 40 days, which was actually 40 years in the wilderness, right? Same thing is going to happen. Mm-hmm. That's how you apply that's how you interpret prophecy. Mm-hmm. Let's take a look at another one. Let's take a look at Ezekiel chapter 4 and verse 6. If you could read that for us, Esmeralda. Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 6.
And when thou hast accomplished them, lie again on thy right side, and thou shalt bear the iniquity of the house of Judah 40 days. I have appointed thee each day for a year.
Now, that to some people, at least to me, seems a little easier because you see it in writing, a day for each year.
Yeah.
Whereas in Numbers, Jesus gave us an example. Mm-hmm. 40 days in the wilderness was actually 40 years. Mm-hmm. So you add the day, you just switch it from day to years, and that helps you to understand how you understand prophecy. Whereas this one here, it makes it simple for us. Right, it spells it out for us.
Spells that word.
That's right.
Yeah. Unfortunately, there are those who would take this doctrine here and apply it to the creation. Which,
yeah, exactly. That's mm-hmm. wrong.
That's wrong, yeah, because the creation is based on the person that created everything, the heavens and the earth, and you can speak of the creation in the Ten Commandments, God who is the God of all, who created the birds and the sea and the fountains. But this would be an example of 40 days being as 40 years. But, you know, again, it has been used and taken out of context.
Yes.
Context is important.
Context is very important.
Why is that? Why would it be taken out of context? And the reason why I say that is because, you know, there is nothing that I found in the Bible that tells us that creation is forthcoming. Right? So how could you see creation as a prophecy? Creation just happened.
It was in the past, yeah.
Yeah.
In the language, I'm not very good with the Hebrew, but my understanding is the language is very particular for a day and not.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And also, the reason why people also apply that as well is because it's watering down of what the Bible says, and they mingle naturalism with creationism. And so they're saying, right. Well, you know, if it's a day for year, then maybe, you know, one day in the creation week may have been like millions of years. I mean, it's mingling two separate philosophies or thinking that are just, they're mutually exclusive. They cannot, by definition, mingle with each other. Otherwise, the creationism and the Bible is nullified. It's just,
I love how God puts it. He puts it the evening and the morning.
Yeah.
And everybody can relate to an evening and a morning as being one day, 24 hours.
Yes.
And he says the evening and the morning were the first day.
Yeah.
And so he tells us exactly how and how long in Genesis. Yes.
And then as the lesson pointed out as well, it's like if you take the, when you get the prophecies like the 2300 days in Daniel 8:14, as the lesson says, you know, it says, you know, and he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. So if you take, if you do 1 year or one day for 1 day, you know, so that's 365 days, divide that into 2,300 days. So that's not very long, you know, and if you look from when that prophecy was given or to when it was supposed to start, I mean, nothing really happened. It was just like, it's just like, what does that mean? But as we now have the benefit of looking back, you know, it actually, we can see how this whole thing plays out. And you see markers. It's when you start combining, you know, 8:14 with the end of Daniel chapter 7 and all this other kind of stuff. You can see how there were certain markers that can only be explained by the day for a year principle.
How do you know whether or not to provide, to apply the day for year principle as opposed to literal days?
Well, you can look at Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13, it speaks of those who that were in power for 40 years. David, Saul, they had given, Saul had reigned for, I think it was 40 years. And so you can look at the history in terms of the 40-year period of Saul and the 40-year period of those that were, that had reigned as kings and queens. And so that can give you an idea that they were speaking of years and not thousands of years.
Okay. Anyone else care to share?
And once again, it's just all based on context, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, Noah didn't float in the ark for 150 years.
No.
Right.
No.
No. It didn't rain. It didn't rain for 40 years.
Right.
I mean, it's context. You know, what is the setting? What is the context? And I can kind of now see, despite the fact that some of these lessons earlier in the quarter were kind of simple, now, I mean, they actually did lay a pretty heavy framework for especially this heavier topic. And we could spend all day on these.
You know, one of the things that helped me out is how I can discern whether or not to apply the prophetic principle to the text that I'm reading is that it's whether or not you start to see symbolic language.
Symbolism, yeah.
Right. You know, you start to see beasts. You start to see horns. You start to see symbolic language.
Yeah.
You know, and obviously we've been talking about it. Is it possible if we used the day, is it possible that it could have happened in that time period?
Yeah.
When Daniel received the 2300-day prophecy, right? Days wasn't very long, right? So he could have conceivably, if they were using just the literal days, he could have seen that in his time period, right?
Yeah.
But it was clear it wasn't going to happen in his time period, so it had to be in the future.
Yeah. And similarly in Daniel chapter 9 with the 70 weeks prophecy, I misspoke earlier, and that's not Daniel chapter 7, but Daniel chapter 9, the 70 week prophecies are, it says, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people, and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for the iniquity, and to bring everlasting righteousness, and to seal the vision and the prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. And then as you read through, it says, after 62 weeks, so it's 49 weeks, in 26, the Messiah will be cut off and not for himself, and the people of the prince shall come and destroy the sanctuary and put an end thereof. In 27, it says, he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, and in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. And so if it's a day-for-day prophecy, once again, you know, 49 weeks isn't that long.
No.
And it's not till, you know, as once again, from our perspective, looking back, we can see these boom, boom.
Wow. Yes. Yes. And it was confusing to Daniel when he received it. I mean, he got sick trying to figure it out. You know, he had to have some help.
And he was finally told, Daniel, it's for another time. Don't worry.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Eventually this will be understood. Right. Yeah. Don't worry.
So he let him know, you know, the Spirit let him know he wasn't going to see this in his lifetime.
Yeah.
You know, because one of the things with whether or not you can tell whether or not a person is a prophet, there's a test that the Bible gives us that we can apply. One of the things is, did it come to pass? You know, well, you know, you have two types of prophecies. You have a time prophecy and you have a conditional prophecy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
God tells us that, hey, look, if you don't stop doing this, this is what's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning you're going to see that in your lifetime. And then you have a time prophecy that whoever the prophet that shares that with us, they may not see it in their lifetime.
Yeah.
Right? It starts, but it's not completely fulfilled until another lifetime. So.
And Jonah's a perfect example of that because,
yes,
you know, he's told to go preach to Nineveh because God says, I'm going to destroy this wicked city. So Jonah does that, but what, at the end of the story, what happened though? They repented, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't till later when their iniquity had built up and they knew better that they were finally destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
In the manner in which
right.
it was going to happen in Jonah's day.
But right. And Jonah kind of wanted him to be destroyed. He didn't want to go there.
He had problems like everybody else.
Yes, he did. Right. He did. But yeah, it's important that we discern the difference between a time prophecy and a conditional prophecy, because the Bible contains both of them.
It does, yeah.
And how you can tell is when God starts to tell us that if you don't stop doing this, then this is going to happen.
Get your spanking.
Right.
I can't
right.
do anything else for you but spank you.
Right. But if he tells you something that's going to happen in the future, there's nothing you can do about that.
He's in control.
Conditional prophecies, we have some control over. All we have to do is do what God wants us to do.
Right? Amen.
Amen. You're right. That's all we have to do. Mm-hmm. And God has been trying to get us to do what he wants us to do for ever since the beginning of time. Let's go to Tuesday, and let's talk about identifying the little horn. If I could get a reader for Daniel chapter 7 in verses 1 to 25. Daniel chapter 7, verses 1 to 25.
In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and wrote the dream. Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heavens strove upon the great sea, and four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse from one another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast, a second, like unto a bear, and it raised up itself on one side, and it had three ribs in the mouth of it, between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, arise, devour much flesh. And this I beheld, and lo, another, like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. After I saw in the night visions and beheld a fourth beast, dreadful, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. I considered the horns and beheld, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. And I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and his hair, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousand thousands ministered unto him. That's a lot of people. Thousand thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. I beheld then, because of the voice of the great works which the horn spake, I beheld even till the beast was slain, and his body destroyed, and given to the burning flame. As concerning the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and time. I saw the night visions And behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. Continue to?
Yes, 225.
You can probably skip some of this part out.
Yeah.
17, I guess, and to the end.
Okay. These great beasts, which are four kings, which shall arise out of the earth. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. Then I would know the truth of the fourth beast, which was diverse from all the others, exceeding dreadful, whose teeth were of iron, his nails of brass, which devoured, break in pieces, and stamped the residue with his feet. And of the 10 horns that were in his head, and of the other which came up, and before whom 3 fell, even of that horn that had eyes, and a mouth that spake very great things, whose look was more stout than his fellows. I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them until the Ancient of Days came and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, and the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down and break it in pieces. And the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise. And another shall arise after them, and he shall be diverse from the first. And he shall subdue 3 kings. And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time.
Esmeralda, if I could get you to read Daniel chapter 8, verses 1 to 13.
In the third year of the reign of King Belshazzar, a vision appeared unto me, even unto me, Daniel, after that which appeared unto me at the first. And I saw in a vision, and it came to pass when I saw that I was at Shushan in the palace, which is in the province of Elam. And I saw in a vision, and I was by the river of Uliah. Then I lifted up mine eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which had 2 horns, and the 2 horns were high, but one was higher than the other, and the higher came up last. I saw the ram pushing westward and northward and southward, so that no beast might stand before him, neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand, but he did according to his will and became great. And I was considering, behold, an he-goat came from the west on the face of the whole earth and touched not the ground, and the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. And he came to the ram that had 2 horns, which I had seen standing before the river, and ran unto him in the fury of his power. And I saw him come close unto the ram, and he was moved with choler against him, and smote the ram and brake his 2 horns. And there was no power in the ram to stand before him, but he cast him down to the ground and stamped upon him. And there was none that could deliver the ram out of his hand. Therefore, the he-goat waxed very great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken, and for it came up 4 notable ones toward the 4 winds of heaven. And out of one of them came forth a little horn, which waxed exceeding great toward the south and toward the east and toward the pleasant land. And it waxed great, and it cast down some of the host of the stars of the ground, and stamped upon them. Yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host, and by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. And a host was given him against the daily sacrifice by reason of transgression, and it cast down the truth to the ground, and it practiced and prospered. Then I heard one saint speaking, and another saint said unto that certain saint which spake, how long shall be the vision concerning the daily sacrifice and the transgression of desolation, to give both to the sanctuary and to the host to be trodden underfoot?
Now, what are some of the common characteristics of the little horn in both chapters?
Wax great, spoke blasphemous words.
Things to change times.
Right. Exactly, yeah.
Self-exalting, yeah. Blasphemous.
Yeah. Okay. And then once again, your interpretation of these two passages all depends upon how you view prophecy. If you take it from a historicist perspective, I mean, you can't but think of one entity or system that fulfills everything. And but if you take a futuristic point of view, once again, this is all still coming up.
Right.
And I actually read one article by, I think it's like the pastor or something like that. It's like one of my email things. I'm not sure I even got subscribed to it. But anyway, it's from a different congregation, obviously. But he takes the preterist view, and they said this is Nero. It's just like, well, really, come on. It doesn't even fit half the characteristics here. You know, some people, even a lot of Christians, they actually relegate this to Islam. Can you believe that? Mm-hmm. And it's just like Islam didn't do any of these things.
No.
You know, and it's just once again, it's just a distraction. It's a distraction.
Well, the key is when you fail to study Scripture the way you're supposed to study Scripture. You know, many people that take that view is because they're not studying Scripture for themselves. They're letting someone else tell them what it's saying.
Yeah.
Right? And really what they're sharing is somebody else's interpretation.
And they buy it hook, line, and sinker.
Yeah, you know, yeah. You mentioned it earlier when you talked about the secret rapture. Bible makes it clear. Jesus doesn't do anything in secrecy.
No.
So where did that come about? Right?
I mean, even his first birth was foretold in Scripture. And,
yes.
Right. And they all knew it. They should have known about it.
Yes.
You know, I mean, it was it's just amazing. Right now I'm doing the Encounter series again for the second time, and it's just amazing how you have this priest who's dedicating Jesus, and he just sees it as a normal, routine child. And then you have this old guy who comes out of the crowd from nowhere, and just this child just enamors him, and they're in it, and he's just like, I have seen the Christ, now I'm ready to die. You know, because he was studying.
Yes.
I mean, it was happening then,
yes.
It's happening now.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, just looking at some of these characteristics of this little horn, it says that the papacy fulfilled the prediction of persecuting the saints of the Most High.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we remember that during the Dark Ages when they persecuted Christians.
Yes.
And it says casting down some of the hosts during the Counter-Reformation when Protestants were slaughtered. It says the papacy sought to change times and laws, and we know that with Constantine in AD 321, making it he made it a rule and edit that Sunday be acknowledged as that day of rest and worship instead of what was formerly the Sabbath.
Right. And then you have the
and still is, by the way, but
yes.
According to the law of who was in power at that time.
Then you have the deleting of the third commandment. You have the splitting of the tenth commandment. And so there's the changing of the laws.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And once again, God has people in every walk of life, every faith. And
right.
That's, you know,
that's
the,
true.
The,
yes.
The,
yes.
You know, just kind of tying that into Wednesdays. I'm not sure if we're ready to go to the investigative
judgment. Yes, we are.
But that's kind of where God, you know, thank goodness God is God, because he knows where our hearts are, you know. And, you know, there's the investigative judgment's another concept that people are just scared of.
Yes.
And the question is why?
Yes, right? Because if we think about the text that was just read, and and Daniel 7 and Daniel 8, we go over there to Wednesday where it talks about the investigative judgment. We see that in the text that was reading, right? That was read. What we see was some type of judgment taking place. Yeah, I asked a question on Tuesday about the characteristics, similar characteristics of the little horn, but that wasn't the only thing that we saw. Mm-hmm. We also saw a judgment scene that was taking place. Mm-hmm. Anybody have any idea what that judgment scene was? That we saw taking place in those two?
On those two?
Oh. Yeah.
Well, each nation is getting their reward according to what they've done.
Yes, yes.
And so
we all have to come before Jesus.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And give an account.
Right.
Of what we did.
Right.
With the talents that was given to us.
Exactly.
You're absolutely right. Now, let's conclude. Let's go to Thursday. Let's talk about.
Just to comment on investigative judgment really fast. I mean, it's a concept that's not new in the Bible, because if you think about it, you know, Adam and Eve in the garden, you know, God came down and said, Adam, where are you? Mm-hmm. And Adam's like, we hid because we were afraid. It's like, well, why were you afraid? You know, God's, and it's for our benefit, really, because it allows us to kind of introspectively take account for what we've done. Daniel chapter 5 is another one with Belshazzar, you know. The reason why his punishment is so severe, I believe, is because he knew better.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, he knew what Daniel had told him, and that's why when the writing on the wall is interpreted, it says, you've been weighed in the balance and found wanting.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's God had investigated his books. He knew what it looked like. It wasn't just arbitrary.
Right.
So.
Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And verses 1 to 13, if I could get a reader for that, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 to 13.
Here we go. Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye be ignorant on how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. But with many of them God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things were our examples, to the intent that we should not lust after evil things, as they also lusted. Neither ye be idolaters, as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Neither let us commit fornication, as some have committed, and fell in one day 3,000, 3 and 20,000. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some also tempted, and were destroyed of serpents. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now all these things happened unto them for examples, and they are also written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Mm. Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. Mm. There hath no temptation taken you, but as is common to man. Mm. But God is faithful, who will not suffer to be tempted above all that you are able, but will with all temptation also make a way of escape, that ye may be able to bear it.
Hallelujah.
Now, amen. Now, to what events in history does Paul refer as he admonishes the Corinthian church? What event was Paul making reference to?
It's long 40 years in the desert.
Yes. 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 What he was telling us, what he was trying to get us to understand, is history tends to repeat itself. Mm-hmm. We've been here before. It's not like we don't have a record of what we've done. Let's take a look at our past, right? It's amazing how history constantly repeats itself. Well, that concludes our Sabbath School panel for this week. I would like to thank you for joining and encourage you to be. Our worship service will start at 10:45. Brother... If I could get you to close us in prayer, please.
Sure. Dearly Father, we thank you once again for what you have given to us, especially for us at the end of this world, and that we can look down through the ages and just see what has taken place and really develop a strong anchor hold and trust in you that what you have said in the past, which has come to pass, that is yet which to become will happen. And we just thank you, Lord, that you are our rock, our shelter, and our refuge, Lord. And we just ask you to, as Paul was writing to the Corinthians, you know, keep our minds on a straight path, always looking towards you and not to ourselves, and not even to the right or to the left at all the stuff that's happening around us, Lord. But just help us to keep our eyes focused on you and to share you with others. We pray this in the name. Amen.
Amen.
I was living in an unacceptable way to God. As a young man, I began attending parties and drinking. I was also going to clubs. One day, I was at home watching TV when a pastor came on and said, "If you ask God to show you his true people, he will show you his church." I didn't know how to talk to God or how to pray, but that night I prayed that God would show me his true church. That was Friday night. The very next morning, as I went to fetch water, I met a friend who asked me where I was going. I told him that I was taking a shower to go out, so he invited me to go to church with him. I said, "Yeah, sure." Then I finished getting water, showered, and went to church with him. I've been in that church ever since and was baptized on May 1st, 2010. I work as a barber. It's from this profession that God blesses me with an income to pay my transport to Caldera, where I go as a missionary. I first went there to preach, and I simply fell in love with the people. So I asked my church to send me there as an assistant. Shortly after I arrived, the leader left, and I became the main person to head this ministry. It's been a difficult journey, but God goes before me. It can cost me 80,000 dobras round trip. When I can't afford this, God gives me the strength to take the bike taxi there and walk the way back. When it's a week of prayer, I do it alone. I go there without anyone. Sometimes the meetings go until 8 or 9 because many people have questions, and I don't like to leave anyone with doubts. So I walk back with God's company. He is the only one who can keep me safe. I arrive safely. Nothing has happened to me. God has always guided me. The people of Caldera are lovely and like to listen to God's word. Our biggest challenge is the lack of a shelter to worship in. On Wednesdays and Fridays, we worship under a solar-powered light. On Sabbaths, we worship in a tiny house. We are praying that God will bless us to get a roof and shelter. Jesus left us a mission. He said, "Go ye into all the world, making disciples and preaching the gospel to all creatures, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." This motivates me to take the message of God to this remote group of people. May God's Spirit bless us to further the work in Caldera and to reach the communities around it. If you are watching this video, please pray that God's Spirit will assist us to win this battle and be able to preach the gospel.
Faithfulness in action. Learn to be content. Living in the United States of America is living in the land that flows with milk and money. The reason many people around the world want to immigrate to the United States is because in this country, people can prosper. But unfortunately, in this country, people also learn not to be satisfied. This is a place where we want to have more, and we don't learn to be happy with little. And many times, what we learn is to covet what our neighbor has. The 10th commandment says in Exodus chapter 20, verse 17, "You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, nor his ox, nor his donkey, nor anything that is your neighbor's. I want to show you this picture of this little boy that is coveting his neighbor's ice cream. He's not happy to have his popsicle. He wants these little girls, he wants to have this little girl's ice cream cone. When we meditate in the sin of covetousness, we realize that when I want to have what my neighbor has, it makes me a very unhappy person. I'm never satisfied with what God has given to me. This is what Hebrews 13:5 says. Let your manner of living be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. When God tells me to live a life free of covetousness, what God is telling me is to be content with what I have. But you will notice that television commercials teaches you the opposite. It always shows a happy family inside a brand new car driving around town. It tells you about the latest cell phone with a face recognition feature to unlock your phone. Soon, we're no longer happy with our old car or cell phone, and we want to have the latest model, even though the model we have is still working just fine. This is what 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 to 9 says. Now godliness with contentment is great gain, but for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing, with these we shall be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts. There are many Adventists who are not content with what they have and desire to be rich, buying houses, cars, furniture, even the latest phone just to compete with the Joneses. And in order to pay for this lifestyle, sometimes they have to work on Sabbath or do not return a faithful tithe, all because they have not learned to be content. Most of us know Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But did you know that this Bible verse has a financial context? This passage is dealing with learning to be content. This is what Philippians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12 says. I'm not saying this because I'm in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. Philippians 12 says, I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The Bible teaches that God has made me a steward of the wealth he has provided. And God wants me to say the same words that Paul said. I have learned to be content. I can do all things through Christ.
Thank you. Blessings and happy Sabbath. Welcome and good morning. Let us start with prayer, where two or more are gathered in his name. Father God, we come to you this morning, this Sabbath morning, thanking you, Father God, for awakening each and every one of us this morning. Father, we call on your mighty name, removing self and allowing you, Father God, to take over. Let the words that come from our mouths today, Father God, be pleasing in your sight. Continue to watch over us and keep us, Father God, in your Son's precious name, Christ Jesus. Amen. Good morning. Good morning, everyone, and welcome, virtual world. Amen. I just want to say thank you for tuning in today and allowing each and every one of us that are here to lift the voice of God. Right now, I would like to call for Sister Esmeralda and Brother Stanley to come for our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. We are all thankful and we are all blessed to be in the house of the Lord. And as we continue on this Sabbath day, this day of rest, Exodus 20 and 8, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Thank you.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Amen, amen. Thank you so very much, Sister Esmeralda, Brother Stanley, and Sister Kristen. Thank you so very much. Now we'll have Sister Esmeralda come and give us the children's story. So everyone there, please have your baby sitting around and waiting to hear God's word coming in the children's story. Sister Esmeralda.
Happy Sabbath, children. I hope you're all watching. And today we're going to talk about creation. It's nice to always remember all the things that Jesus made and how we were made and this earth was made. So today we're going to go over Genesis chapter 1. So if you have your little Bibles, you can open to Genesis chapter 1 and read along with me. And I drew some pictures, and hopefully you can use your imagination too to just imagine how great and a powerful God we have that created us and created this whole world. Okay, so we're going to start with Genesis chapter 1. It says, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and the darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day." So here's my picture. Can you imagine? There was nothing there, nothing. Just close your eyes and you see nothing, right? And then he just spoke these words, and he said, "Let there be light," right? And then he created the earth, just a big circle, right? Here's my drawing of light and just a circle around here in the universe, right? And that was the first day, okay? And it starts, the day starts from evening to morning, okay? So from when the sun sets until it sets again, that's one whole day. Now let's see. Verse 6, "And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so." So the earth had a lot of water on it, and then he divided it, right? Water from the sky. So here we go. Got water down here, and then we have the sky. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. Here's the second day. Okay, so he's taking his time, and he's making it really beautiful. And now let's read in verse 9. "And God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after its kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the trees yielding fruit whose seed was in itself after its kind. And God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the third day." So then he made all the grass and flowers and the fruit trees and all the food for his creation that was coming next, right? Okay, so that was the third day. And verse 15. "And let them be for light," 14. "And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. And God set them in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. and to rule over the day and over the night and to divide the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the fourth day. So there's the sun and the moon and the stars on the fourth day. Verse 20. And God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creatures that have life and fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven. And God created great whales and every living creature. Creature that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven. And God created great whales and every living creature that moveth, which the waters brought forth and abundantly after their kind, and every winged fowl after its kind, and God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and the fowl multiply in the earth. And the evening and the morning were the fifth day. So there are all the birds and all the fish and the whales. My simple drawings there. So imagine God is just saying these things, and all these wonderful animals and things are appearing on the earth. And then God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing and beast of the earth after his kind. And it was so. And God made the beast of the earth after his kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind, and God saw that it was good. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing and that moveth upon the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed to you, it shall be for meat. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat. And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. So then God made, first he made our food, and then he made all the animals so that they can have all the food to eat, right? And we can have wonderful fruits and vegetables and nuts to eat. So chapter 2 says, thus the heaven and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. So on the seventh day is Saturday. Today is the seventh day. Saturday is the last day of the week. And we come to church, and we are reminded of God and his creation. And we need to spend this special holy day, which he sanctified. And he said, I need you to rest on this day, and I need you to come to me, and I need you to talk to me, and I need you to spend time with me, and I need you to go out and walk and look at the creation that I made. Look at the trees, smell the fresh air, feel the grass on your feet, or go touch the sand in the ocean, or just go out into nature and enjoy the wonderful creation that I made for you. So God said, the seventh day, I just want you to just be with me, and I just want you to talk to me, and I want you to spend time with me, and I want you to see all the wonderful things that I have made for you, because I love you. So just always remember, God's creation. And if you forget the things that he made each day, just go to Genesis 1 and read it over and over, and just remember that God loves you. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Sister Esmeralda. Young people, I pray that you were as excited and enjoyed this lesson as much as I did. Thank you so much. At this time, it is our time for announcements. And we want to make sure that each and every one of you come out. There will be someone here to receive your tithes and offerings. So always remember that the lights are on, the building is here, but without your support, we won't be able to continue. Also, remember to tune in Sabbath morning at 9:30 so that you can worship and fellowship and learn about the Word of God. This morning, the discussion was extra, extra special. And I thank each and every one of you that served on the panel. Now, I know this is quite different, but then I'm quite different as well. So in my announcements, I just want to say happy birthday to everyone that has a birthday in the month of June. I know we have a few people that are right here in our congregation. Little David, he had his fourth birthday. He told me this morning that he turned 4 years old. That's a big number. 1, 2, 3, 4. How many of you remember when you were 4 years old? And America, okay? And America, her mother is Sister Esmeralda. And she, oh my goodness, is such a beautiful young lady. So anyone that knows America, please wish them happy birthday. And Brother Joe, his daughter Kristen, is our pianist this morning. His birthday, too, was, matter of fact, today, huh? The 13th? The 15th, okay. So we want to extend a special happy birthday to Brother Joe. And to anyone else out there in the virtual world, we want to say happy birthday and God bless you. And we will continue on with the announcements.
Hello, viewer. In this video, we will be looking at how to do online giving for your church through the Adventist Giving website. The first thing you want to do is open up your web browser and then type in Adventist Giving. As you can see, Adventist Giving is the top link, and we'll go ahead and click on that. Once we arrive at the page, you can see that it gives you the option to select your church. But before we go through a donation process, we'd encourage you to create an account. This will allow you to keep track of your donations. In order to create an account, click the login button. If you already have an account, this is where you can log in. If you don't, click the sign up button to begin the registration process. Here you can put in all of your information in order to make your account. So we're going to go ahead and do that. And once we have it all filled up, we'll click register. As you can see, the page lets us know that our registration has been complete, and now we have the option of logging in. Now I'm going to go back to the home page and go through the login process from there. As you can see, we are now logged in, and now we can go ahead and select our church. We want to emphasize that you intentionally select the church that you want to donate to. As you see, when I type in Clovis, two churches come up, one in California and the other one in New Mexico. As many church names are very similar, we encourage you to make an intentional donation. In some instances, your church may not be registered with Adventist Giving. If this is the case, when you click on your church, it'll bring you to this page. Here you can fill in your information as well as your church treasurer's contact information. This will send them an email to let them know the steps they can take to register their church with Adventist Giving. If you happen to be the treasurer, you can go ahead and register your church here. Now that we're back at the home page, we can begin our donation. So we'll go ahead and type in our church, and then it'll bring us to this page where we have different options, including tithe, local church, conference and union, and world budgets. If at this point you forgot to select your church, no worries, you can go ahead and do it right here. Once we've placed a dollar amount, we will click Continue. On this page, we can add a new payment option. We can either add a new credit or debit card or a new electronic check. Once we've made our selection, we can input our information to complete that payment option. If you have already registered a payment option, it'll look something like this. At this point, you can select Continue to proceed. As we arrive to this page, you can see your total donation. At this point, I like to click Confirmation Email. This will send me an email notification letting me know that my donation was received. If at this point you still haven't selected a church or you'd like to make a change, you can still do so here. Once you're all done, you can click Confirm Donation. The site will let you know that your donation was received. You can also download the Adventist Giving app on your phone and complete your donation process from there.
Welcome back, and thank you. Right now, we will be blessed by the sounds coming from Sister Esmeralda and Brother Stanley. As they come and just bless us in song. Our first song is Oh, How I Love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Smile and thank the Lord for each and every day.
I love to sing His word. It sounds like music in my ears, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of a Savior's blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest woe, who any sorrow shares a heart that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me.
Amen. Yes, He did. Amen. Yes, He did. And yes, He does. He continually loves us, even when we forget to love ourselves. Next, we have such a beautiful selection. And each and every one of us has this. We have the power in the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
The next selection, number 294, excuse me, Power in the Blood.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder. wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Yes, yes it is. Yes, there's power in the blood. As we continue on, I'd rather have Jesus. Amen. Number 327, I'd rather have Jesus.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nailed, pierced hand. To be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name. To be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. Of rarest bloom, he's sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus than let him lead, than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
What a beautiful song. Thank you. Thank you, Kristen. Sister Kristen. I had to make sure I remembered. Thank you, Brother Stanley. Thank you, Sister Esmeralda. Now, we have a treat. Not every church has a doctor, but our church does. And our health spotlight this morning is coming from Dr. Michael Bowman. Dr. Mike.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. As usual, today I'm going to just read some excerpts that have been published in the health literature within the last couple of months. And you can actually find these same summaries at a website called pcrm.org. And there you can also find other health topics as well. So this first one is interesting. It says, dairy does not protect against bone fractures in menopausal women. And the summary reads as this. Dairy consumption does not protect against non-traumatic bone fractures or improve bone mineral density in menopausal women, according to a study that was published online in Menopause, which is a journal. Researchers analyzed dairy consumption and bone mineral density in the femoral neck and lumbar spine among 1,955 participants in the study of women and health across the nation. The participants were assessed over a 10-year a menopausal transition time frame. The authors placed the participants in different categories regarding what kind of dairy they consumed and how much they did. Basically, it ranged from milk products, cheese, yogurt, averaging and ranging about 2.5 servings a day. The results, guess what? Showed no benefit in consuming dairy for bone loss or fracture risk among this population. And it's actually interesting. There's actually arguments on the other side that it actually potentially increases the risk of fractures and bone loss. It's a huge controversy, but you can sort it out yourself. anyways, all right, this next one was actually just published just a few days ago in June 9 of 2020. And it actually comes from the American Cancer Society. And the title reads this, the American Cancer Society calls for more plant, less red and processed meat. It says the American Cancer Society's diet and physical activities guidelines published on June 9 calls for increased plant-based foods and excluding or limiting red and processed meats to reduce cancer risk. Developed by the National Panel of Experts in Cancer Research, Public Policy, Prevention, and more, the guideline recommends dietary patterns for individuals for cancer prevention within a community context. In addition to highlighting physical activity and maintaining a healthy weight, recommendations focusing on eating nutrient-dense fruits, vegetables, legumes, and whole grains, and limiting or excluding red and processed meats to reduce the risk of cancer. Research consistently associates eating patterns that follow these guidelines will reduce the risk of cancer, mortality, and chronic disease, and improve environmental impact. The report also called for community initiatives and public policies to increase access to healthy foods. All right. So, bottom line, eat your fruits and vegetables, and leave away the animal-based stuff. Lastly, this study actually very near and close to us as a church, at large, and it's interesting. It says canned and cooked tomatoes protect against prostate cancer. I know some individuals that just hate tomatoes, but they will eat ketchup, which may prove beneficial. So you're not, but anyways, here it goes, all right? So it says consuming tomatoes may reduce the risk of prostate cancer according to a study published in Cancer Causes and Control. And listen to this, researchers followed more than 27,000 Adventist men without cancer and monitored tomato intake and cancer incidence rates. Those who consumed canned or cooked tomatoes at least four times or more a week reduced their risk of prostate cancer when compared to those who never consumed tomatoes. Results showed a stronger association with consumption of 71 grams per day, or about a third cup, compared to no tomato intake. The authors attribute the lowered risk to increased bioavailability of lycopene, a type of carotenoid in the processed and cooked tomato products. These results are particularly strong in the African-American participants, which supported dietary interventions as a viable preventative measure for at-risk populations. So the long and short of it, eat your tomatoes. And it's kind of interesting when you look at other things like in the berries and I guess tomatoes as well, when they're like chopped and pureed, that makes the those wonderful carotenoids, all those antioxidants, more easily absorbable into the body, and therefore you can take it up and your body can actually assimilate it better, versus eating like a handful of blueberries or blackberries, or even I guess eating a tomato. So if you have a blender, I guess process it, and you'll get more of the nutrients out of it, bottom line. So so eat your fruits, vegetables, whole grains, beans, nuts, legumes, and once again, it's all because we're in God's service and we need to remain healthy to do such. Thank you.
Amen. That was really interesting. Thank you very much. I don't think I'll end up with any cancer in that aspect. And the ketchup, I think it will work pretty good as well, the tomatoes, huh? Oh, okay, very good, very good. Praise God. Next, we'd like to have Sister Esmeralda come up and offer prayer for us this morning. Each and every one of us needs to partake. So those that are at home, would you please bow your heads and join Sister Esmeralda in prayer.
Dear loving and heavenly Father, we are gathered here in your presence, Lord, to worship you, to give you all the honor and all the glory, Lord, because you are our God, because you love us, because you created us, and because you're coming very soon, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the truth that is in your word, because you have opened our eyes to see the things that have passed and the things that are to come. And we thank you, Lord, for guiding us, for guiding our families, our church. And we ask that you will help us to wake up and see what we need to do in these last days of Earth's history, Lord. That you will guide our church, that you will help us to listen to your voice and do your will, Lord. And I pray for those who are sick at home or in the hospitals, Lord, that you will heal them, that you will give them peace in their hearts and help them to see that you are a loving God, that you love them and that you want them to be well, Lord. And I ask for those who are so worried about this COVID-19, that you will give them also peace, that you will help them through this pandemic, and that you will guide us all so that we can bring your message of truth and hope to those who are in need of it, who don't know, Lord, the truth. Help us to be brave and strong and go out and give this wonderful message to those who don't have it, Lord. Thank you. We ask your blessing over this church service and over our brother who's going to give your word today, and let it be all done according to your will and not ours. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen, Sister Esmeralda. And I pray that each and every one of you received a special blessing with that prayer. Our scripture reading for today comes, out of Revelation 3:20. Behold, I stand at the door and a knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. May the Lord have the blessing and the reading of this word. At this time, we have our special music. And it's from a gentleman that I know quite well, Brother Stanley Mackey, with his own rendition of Amazing Grace. Brother Stanley Mackey. Thank you.
amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why Christ came to love me so. He looked beyond all my faults and saw my need. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary, to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous his grace that caught my falling soul. He looked beyond all my faults and saw my need. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary, to the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous his grace had caught my falling soul. He looked beyond all my faults and saw my.
Brother Stanley, and thank you, Sister Kirsten. I pray that each and every one of you are ready for the word. The gentleman that will be bringing the word today comes from Madera Fellowship. Our first elder, I would like to introduce to you Elder Frank Sanders Jr., and he will be bringing the word, and we're ready for you. God bless you.
Thank you, Sister Anita, for that wonderful introduction. I would like to thank the leadership of the Madera Fellowship Church for allowing me to stand before you today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your mercy and your grace. Father, hide me. Hide Frank behind the cross. I pray, Father, that I decrease so that you may increase. Let only Jesus be seen. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. If we hear his knock and open the door, he will come in and be our guest. That's the promise. We think of Holman Hunt's great painting in St. Paul's Cathedral in London. You see, the Savior stands at the door with a lantern in his hand while the shadows of night are pressing in. knocks at the door. He listens. He waits. But there is not a sign of movement within. One critic called the artist's attention to the missing latch and was told that it was on the inside of the door. You see, the door represents a person's heart, which when Christ knocks, must be opened by that person. There was a small boy viewing this great picture. He asked his father, he said, "Daddy, why don't they let Jesus in?" The father answered, "I don't know." A moment later, the little fellow said, "I know why they don't let him in. They live in the basement and can't hear him knock." Could that be the trouble with any of us? Do we live below the level of recognition in spiritual things? In our message today, we're going to tackle the question, why would someone not let Jesus in? In Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, the seven lampstands represent seven churches in Asia Minor, which in turn represent seven stages in the church history. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 13, Jesus is seen walking in the midst of the lamps. This means that Jesus walks in the midst of church history. What does Jesus do while he walks in the midst of the seven lampstands that represent seven consecutive stages of church history? He keeps the light of the church burning. Amen, somebody. Now, there are seven eras of history in the Christian church. Each church, each era is symbolic of a particular church. You have the church of Ephesus. It was during the time period 31 to 100 AD. It was a desirable church because of its love for Jesus. But then it started to lose its first love. Then you have the church of Smyrna during the time period 100 to 313 AD. It was a church facing persecution and death. Then you have the church of Pergamum during the time period 313 to 538. In that church, we saw the introduction of idolatry and the traditions of men. Then you have the church of Thyatira. It was during the time period 538 to 1517. In that church, we saw a deeper level of apostasy. Then you have the church of Sardis during the time period 1517 to 1833. Now this church, it looked alive, but in actuality it was dead. That's why they referred to it as the dead church. Then we have the church of Laodicea during the time period 1844 to the close of probation. That's the time period that we're in. It was referred to as the lukewarm church. We're going to spend time this morning talking about that lukewarm church of Laodicea. Please turn to your Bibles in Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, starting with verse number 14. What scripture did I say? 14. Revelation chapter 3, verse 14. Starting with verse number 14. Amen. And it reads as follows. And to the angel of the church of Laodiceans write, these things says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of creation of God. I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. I could wish you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Because of you, I am rich, have become wealthy. Because you say I am rich, have become wealthy and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repeat. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him, and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. You see, we see five parts to the Laodicean passage. In verses 14 and the first part of 15, we see the person who delivers the message. In the second part of verse 15 to 17, we have the diagnosis of the disease or the rebuke. And in verse 18, we have the remedy or cure for the disease. In verses 19 to 20, we see the reason or purpose for the message. There's always a purpose. And in verse 21, we see the reward for those who accept the message. Now, there are some important details about Laodicea. You see, this is the church of the end time because it is the seventh of the seven churches in the series. This is the church which exists during the period of judgment, as denoted by its name, judging the people. Not only is it the church of the judgment, but the message itself will cause the shaking among God's people. You see, many may arise and oppose it when it is preached. This is the only church which Jesus has nothing good to say. Most of our pioneers believe that the Laodicean message applied to the nominal Christians. However, this idea was shattered by the spirit of prophecy when she wrote, the message to the church of the Laodiceans applies especially to the people of God today. It is a message to professing Christians who have become so much like the world that no difference can be seen. Now in verse 14, we have the messenger to the church of Laodicea. We know that this message is ironclad because the messenger is described in the following terms. He says he is the Amen. He is the beginning, the beginner of the creation of God, and therefore knows all about his creation. He is the faithful and the true witness. He says, I know your works. This message is trustworthy. Why? Because Jesus himself delivers it. Now let's talk about the diagnosis of the deadly disease. You see, Jesus and Laodicea look upon the disease in radically different ways. You see, Laodicea says she is rich, that she is luxuriously clothed, and that she has 20/20 vision, and that she is happy. But Jesus says that Laodicea is poor, naked, blind, and miserable. There is something terribly wrong with Laodicea. Her problem is that she refuses to believe that she is sick. How can a physician treat someone who does not believe he or she is sick? See, the problem with Laodicea is that she is lukewarm. Lukewarm water is a combination of hot and cold. Laodicea has something hot and she has something cold. So what does she have that is hot? So let's talk about some of that. Let's take a look at some of the hot elements of Laodicea. The external looks pretty well. It's kind of like that fig tree that Jesus saw that was full of leaves. But when he got close enough to examine the tree, he found no fruit. From the looks on the outside, you would think there's plenty of fruit. But when you get there, you find neither. None. She has a rich denominational history. She has a health system and health principles that are the envy of the world. She has the largest Protestant religious school system in the world. She is working in over 200 countries of the world and is baptizing thousands of people worldwide in a single day. She has hundreds of publishing houses which spread her literature on a global basis. She has an organizational system which spans the world and financial policies which distribute her resources so as to benefit the world field. She has a belief system that with solid biblical foundation, all her doctrines fit together like the links of a chain. Her members have a very unique lifestyle. They don't smoke or drink. They dress modestly. They don't eat pork or shrimp. They tithe their income. They go to church on the Sabbath. Amen. And they don't dance or go to the theater. They consider themselves the peculiar people of the Lord. Externally, all looks nice to the eye of the beholder. All of the form of religion and piety is there for the world to behold. They function like a gigantic fine-tuned and oil machine. Now let's look at some of the cold aspects of Laodicea. You see, the problem with Laodicea is not on the outside. The problem is on the inside. The problem is not primarily with the behavior, but it's with the heart. Laodicea is hypocritical. It shows one face on the outside when it is totally different on the inside. Laodicea is composed of half-hearted Christians. The Laodiceans are in a position of carnal security. Laodicea is filled with people who have patchwork characters. The members of Laodicea are almost Christians. The Laodiceans are neutral and non-committal. They are neither good Christians or good non-Christians. They have an insipid religious experience. Their spiritual life is tasteless. They are role players. They act on the outside the opposite of what they really are on the inside. They are Christians in the intellect, but the truth has not reached their heart. This is why in Revelation 3:20, Jesus is outside the heart begging to come in. You see, Laodiceans have the same problem as the Pharisees in Christ's day. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 20, Jesus calls for a greater righteousness than the Pharisees. What is the righteousness of the Pharisees? See, the Pharisees had an external righteousness that did not flow from their heart. Jesus calls upon the church to have a righteousness that flows from the heart. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 21 and 22, to the Pharisees, killing was an external act of depriving someone of physical life. But to Jesus, killing was a heart attitude of hatred towards one another. In Matthew 5, chapter 5, verse 27 to 28, the Pharisees defined adultery as an external act. Jesus defined adultery as something that occurred in the heart. In Mark chapter 7, verse 6, the Pharisees honored God with their lips, but their hearts was far from the Lord. Now, in regards to the Pharisees and the publican, the Pharisee was full of himself and felt righteous because of all of his good works. But the publican, he felt his need. Laodicean's problem is not with the outside, what she professes, but with the inside, that which she is. The problem of Laodicea is not with sins, but with sin. The sin in the heart is hidden by apparently good external behavior. It is no use to eliminate sinful actions without killing the sinful root, which produces those actions. The way to kill a tree is not by cutting off its leaves, but by pulling it up by the roots. In order to truly change behavior, we must go to the heart or to the root, such as pride, selfishness, covetousness, envy, hatred. With many in Laodicea, the truth has reached the intellect, but it has not changed the heart. Jesus is outside the heart of Laodicea. Who then is in control of the heart? I'm glad you asked. It's none other than self. You see, the problem is with the heart. The heart is cold and the works are hot. And the result? Lukewarm. The problem with Laodicea is not primarily with her actions, but with the motivations which lead to these actions. Now, what is Laodicean disease? See, Laodicea does the right things for all the wrong reasons, or with the wrong motivation, such as to impress men and to impress God. The outside looks good, but the inside is rotten. Laodicea has the form and theory of the truth, the form of godliness, but no power. Ritual and beliefs are right, but there is no power. Now, we have two radical different views. See, Laodicea thinks she's rich. She has 20/20 eyesight. She looks jewishly clothed, and she's happy. But Jesus says that she's poor, blind, naked, miserable, and wretched. Obviously, Laodicea is self-deceived. Now, how do you convince someone to seek treatment who does not believe that he or she is sick? Only the Holy Spirit can give us the capacity to understand the fatal seriousness of our illness. However, God proposes three remedies for Laodicea. In verse 18, God talks about a gold tried in fire. Galatians 5:6, we're talking about faith that works by love. Galatians 5:6 reads, "For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything, but faith working through love." You see, Laodicea needs a faith which has love as the motivating force. God proposes white garments. Isaiah 61:10, we see garments representing righteousness. Isaiah 61:10 reads as, "I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness." And God proposes eye salve. Matthew chapter 15, verse 14, "The Pharisees lacked spiritual discernment to see their condition as God saw it." Matthew chapter 15, verse 14 reads as follows, "Let them alone. They are blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind leads the blind, both will fall in the ditch." See, it's unlike Stevie Wonder and Ray Charles, who had physical blindness. These people had spiritual blindness. Spirit of prophecy tells us that the true witness counsels to buy of him gold tried in the fire, white raiment, and eye salve. The gold here recommended as having been tried in the fire is faith and love. It makes the heart rich, for it has been purged until it is pure. And the more it is tested, the more brilliant is its luster. The white raiment is purity of character, the righteousness of Christ imparted to the sinner. This is indeed a garment of heavenly texture that can be bought only of Christ for a life of willing obedience. The eye salve is that wisdom and grace that enables us to discern between the evil and the good, and to detect sin under any disguise. God has given his church eyes, which he requires them to anoint with wisdom, that they may see clearly. But many would put out the eyes of the church if they could, for they would not have their deeds come to the light. lest they should be reproved. See, the divine eye salve will impart clearness to the understanding. In conclusion, I want us to remember, Jesus stands at the door of the heart. Revelation chapter 3, verse 20 says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him and him with me." See, the big problem is Jesus is outside the heart. This must mean that self is in control of the heart. Now, there are two kinds of selfish hearts. You have those who claim to serve God and do as they please. You see, they wish to be saved in their sins. And then you have those who claim to serve God and seek to cover up their evil hearts with a veneer of good works. They wish to be saved by their good works. See, God looks at the inward motivation of our acts. God is not impressed with what we eat. God is less impressed with what we eat than he is and why we eat it. God is less impressed with what we give than why we give it. God is less impressed with what we do than why we do it. God is less impressed with what we wear than why we wear it. God is less impressed with where we go than why we go. You see, I got good news for you, brothers and sisters. I got good news for you. The good news is that we don't have to be Laodiceans. Each of us has the opportunity to take the advice given by Jesus and with the power of his blood rise above the apathy of our present condition. We can wear the special badge of the church of brotherly love and have the protection of God through the great test that is coming. Then, brothers and sisters, we can experience the promise of Revelation chapter 3, verse 21, where it says, "To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne." My appeal to you is very simple. See, Jesus is standing at the door of your heart, just waiting to get in. All you have to do, just open the door and let him in. And if you do that, if you just open the door and let him in, then you might just understand what Patti LaBelle said when she said, "I got a new attitude." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again. Father, we pray. We pray, Father, that we know you've been knocking on the door for quite some time. And for whatever reason, we have failed to open that door. Father, we pray now that everyone that hears your voice, that hears you knocking, open that door, Father, so that you may come in and change our heart. We love you and we praise you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
May we please have you come? Brother Stanley and Sister Esmeralda. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. And that does not come from a lukewarm church.
God sent his son.
They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he
Brother Stanley, Sister Esmeralda, Brother Frank, Brother George, thank you so very much. I would like to now ask Brother Stanley to give us our benediction.
Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your mercy and grace. We thank you for bringing us here again another Sabbath. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done for us. Lord, we just worship and we adore you for being in control of everything. Riches and honor comes from you and you alone, and you are ruler of all mankind. Your hand controls power and might, and it is at your discretion that men are made great and given strength. So Lord, we ask for that strength. We ask that you be with us during this week. We ask that you be with those members, Father, who are listening and who are not able to listen, that who are may be sick, Father, on their sick beds. We ask for those that have been bereaved, Father, lost a loved one. Lord, we just thank you. And now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen, amen, and amen.